Hey everybody, Brion McClanahan here. The woke madness in history education is off the rails. Well, how do we change it? McClanahanacademy.com. And because you listen to this podcast, if you use the coupon code PODCAST at checkout, you get 25% off every day, all day, 365 days a year on every class at McClanahanacademy.com. So go to McClanahanacademy.com, use coupon code PODCAST at checkout, and get a real history education at 25% off. If you like this podcast and you want it without advertisements, head over to patreon.com and become a member of the Brion McClanahan Show. For 10 bucks a month, you get all the podcasts ad-free, including video, and you also get a special Q&A podcast. I'm only going to answer your questions, your listener-generated episodes, through those Q&A. So head over to patreon.com, get this podcast ad-free, no ads, not even things like this, and you really do help support the Brion McClanahan Show with really cool stuff on the back end. If you like this podcast, don't forget to follow me on social media. Find me on Twitter, now X, at Brion McClanahan, also on Facebook, at Brion McClanahan, and on YouTube, where you can watch the podcast, at Brion McClanahan. It's a great time. I'd love to see you there. Did you know the Civil War never ended? Well, according to the New Statesman, that's true. So I'll talk about it on this episode of the Brion McClanahan Show.
It's time to think locally and act locally. Welcome to the Brion McClanahan Show.
Welcome back to the Brion McClanahan Show. Glad to be back on the program. Very glad to be here. Well, as the New Statesman said, the Civil War never ended. Now, this is a really interesting argument, and it's something that the left has been running around saying for several years now. And I have talked about some other pieces that address this. But this piece by Jill Filipovic at the New Statesman is a nice summary of all the idiotic positions that these people have. In fact, it's so historically ignorant that I almost considered not doing it. But had a colleague of mine say, hey, have you seen this piece? It's really funny. And it encapsulates everything they believe about modern American society. And it really suffers from this derangement syndrome that the South is the root of everything evil in America. Now remember, both the Republican Party and the left think this. This is why it was shocking when Donald Trump said at the end of his administration that Robert E. Lee was a great general. And everybody went ballistic about this, including people in the Republican Party. How dare you say that? But of course, that would be red meat. That would be the fodder that these people on the left would need to say, well, there you go. You see, the Civil War never ended. If we think Robert E. Lee was a great general, that means the war never ended. But of course, that's false, because we know there were people in the North, even when they won the war, even when they thought the Northern position won, that believed that Lee was a great general. You didn't have to be a Southern partisan to think that at all. There were people in the North that thought Stonewall Jackson was a great general. That wasn't uncommon. But to the dopes on the left, and of course the West Coast Straussians and all the people that believe that somehow the South is the root of all evil, that becomes a problem. If you say anything positive about the South or Southern history, the Southern tradition, whatever it is, it's a problem. Because, well, those are the bad guys. You got to have clear good guys and bad guys in this ideological struggle in America for the heart and soul of what America really is. And of course, the South takes that position. It ignores real American history. And that's what this piece is. It's, as I said, it's historically ignorant. It doesn't have an anchor to anything. It's just based on straw men, boogeymen, fabricated history of the United States. And it's horrible. So let's get into it because it's not just horrible, it's very funny too. Again, Jill Filipovic, she's a writer. She has a pretty large following on social media. And the inspiration for this particular piece is this new film coming out. It comes out April 12th, somewhere in there. And on purpose it comes out at that time, because that's about the time that the U.S. quote-unquote Civil War ended. But not according to Jill Filipovic, because, the war went on. In fact, the South won the war. This is the most idiotic position that I think anybody could say, that somehow the South won the war. If you had said that to anybody about 50 or 60 years ago, heck, even 30 years ago in some ways, they would have laughed in your face. What are you talking about? The South won the war? Take a look around. We live in what the North wanted. The South didn't win anything. If you go back and look at Russell Kirk's The Conservative Mind, written in the 1950s, he talks about the post-war period, the immediate post-war period, as a frustrating period in American conservatism. Why? Because the South was basically absent, and what you had were Northern conservatives who really weren't that conservative running the conservative disposition in America. They were the ones with power. The South had no power. Even when you get to the early 20th century, the South really didn't have any power. Now, they talked a lot about return of home rule in their states, or at least the resumption of what you would consider to be somewhat of federalism. But even there, this was done because the North wanted that too. And a nice example of that is the fact that even in the 1970s, Boston was essentially still segregated. This is why you had the riots in Boston, where you had the very famous image, Soiling of Old Glory, where there's a guy in Boston, a white guy hitting a black guy in the face with a U.S. flag. That was Boston, 1970s. It wasn't in the South. So this article where the South wins the war and the South, I mean, the title is The Civil War Never Ended. The questions that sent Americans to war with each other in the late 19th century still shape the country. And there are some really interesting accusations here, or points, that those on the right also make about the left. Maybe she's on to something. Maybe this is actually bigger than just the war, though. And maybe the war was about more than just these social issues, which, of course, people at the time, North and South, were saying. So let's get into it. In Civil War, a new dystopian action film set in the near future, separatist rebels in Texas and California band together against an authoritarian president while brave journalists risk their lives to cover the conflict. Written and directed by Alex Garland, the movie taps into one of the most fascinating aspects of American culture, the collective obsession of with our original Civil War, and especially the fetishization of it by the losers. This is a fetish. It's a fetish to be interested in the war. Now, think about what she just said there. It's a fetish. These people should have just gotten over this thing. It's a fetish to be interested in a conflict that cost the South about a quarter, close to a third, of its white male population, when half or more, I mean, as much as 75% of military-age white Southerners fought in the conflict, and you had the tremendous amount of economic, social, and destruction, dislocation that particular war cost. Yes, people are going to be interested in this war. It's not a fetish. It's history. And to say this is a fetish is to disregard what history really is, which is the remembered past. And when you remember the past, you're going to have an interest in how these things play out. This is what I find fascinating. These people really don't understand anything. But of course, Northerners had a quote-unquote fetish about it as well. I mean, this is why they built monuments across the North. This is why they had various remembrances. This is why they had the Grand Army of the Republic. I mean, this is just stupid to say this. But the losers call it a fetish. What an idiotic statement. But what do you expect from a journalist, lawyer, and author who doesn't really know anything? What Civil War, which will be released on April 12th, doesn't aim to do is address the original Civil War's fault lines, North versus South, and a battle over whether Southern states could continue enslaving human beings. Now, this is a really interesting point. So that's the fault line. Could the South continue to do this? Well, if you go back and you read, I don't know, let's think about a Northerner that might be pretty important. Like, I don't know, Abraham Lincoln? What did he say at the beginning of the war? I don't have any interest in ending slavery in the South. Not at all. In fact, here's a constitutional amendment that I support that would make slavery permanent in the southern states. Yeah, I support that. How about David Wilmot? There was actually an interesting exchange that over the weekend on X, where there was some dopey historian named EJ talking about David Wilmot. Somehow David Wilmot became this symbol of abolitionism. Well, David Wilmot never said he would end slavery in the South. In fact, it wasn't until the war and the Confiscation Acts, when the North was looking to win the war and they started using the authority of the federal government to try to cut the property of the South so they could win, not for any altruistic reasons. Of course, for Wilmot, there were some that said, well, this thing needs to go away, we need to get rid of it. But regardless, in 1850, David Wilmot made a speech. This is over the Compromise of 1850, where he said he would let slavery exist in the South for centuries to come. Well, that's a really interesting statement, considering somehow the North wanted to end slavery in the South. Now, you can say, well, wait, that was 1850. What about 1860 and 61? I give to you the amendment that would have kept slavery in the South permanent. It would have made it permanent. It could not abolish it. An amendment that Lincoln supported. Oh, by the way, Northern states still had slavery during the war. So if this war is a crusade over the South continuing to enslave human beings, well, what about the North? If that was the case, it would have ended it immediately. Of course, they didn't do that. In fact, Lincoln and Seward were courting people in North Carolina, Tennessee, Virginia. Don't leave. Your institution is protected. We're not going to do anything about it where it already exists. The issue, of course, was the Western territories, the Western states. It wasn't about slavery that already existed. And everyone knew it. Now, Southerners were concerned with a Northern majority. Maybe they could do something illegal. We know that, I mean, this is what Calhoun said in the Positive Good speech. Well, if we have the power to have unconstitutional protective tariffs, unconstitutional banks, unconstitutional, I mean, you take your pick, internal improvements, well, you can do something else that's unconstitutional. So they worried about that to a point. But if you look at the pro-union speeches in the South, they all made this point. Slavery is never better protected than in the United States. So, that's what the war was about. Over whether Southern states could continue enslaving human beings? Baloney. The war was about preserving the Union. Nor does it interrogate how those lines continue to divide American politics. See, that is the dividing line in American politics, how race and racial animus influence voting and policy. I mean, that's it. This is why people vote, because of race and racial animus. How the Confederacy's culture, political preferences, and desire for minority rule remain at the heart of the day's Republican Party. And that's a really interesting statement, one of the most idiotic statements in the entire piece. Because the Republicans will say this is the Democrats doing this. What is the Democrat Party but a collection of minority groups? Is that really majority rule, or is it majority-minority rule? I don't know. I mean, we'd have to ask that question. I think it's a very important question. The Democratic Party is exactly what James Madison worried about in the Federalist, if you want to go back to that, where you have a collection of minority interests that are going to band together with the sole interest of acquiring power and using it to their advantage. So is it really the Republican Party interested in minority rule? Are the Republicans really the minority? And if it's racial animus that's driving this, well, think about that. There, she's saying racial animus dictates voting and policy. And the Republicans want minority rule. So the last time I checked, if that was how Americans voted, if this is all we did, if it was racial animus, and if the Republican Party was representative in her, what she's saying is the Republican Party is just a bunch of white people. White people still make up 60% of the American population, more than that, 65%, I think, something like that. 60 to 65% is still white in America. So that would mean that that would be the majority if we're just all voting on race, which we know doesn't happen. Now, generally on the left, it does. In fact, this is the narrative they push. Vote by your race. I mean, this is the identity politics that the left has been pursuing for years. If you don't vote the party line because of your race, if you think outside of that, well, you're some kind of heretic. You see. But nobody thinks that about white America, generally. I mean, you can vote however you want, and you're not a heretic if you vote one way or the other. But if you're of a minority race in America, well, if you vote outside what the overlords tell you you should be doing, well, then you're a heretic. Which is weird for people that say, we're not really concerned about that. Only the other side is. This is a weird argument. Again, a stupid piece. And how two divergent narratives of the Civil War undergird very different ideas of what America should be. Two different narratives. Well, what are those narratives? One is states' rights. The other is slavery. You see, those are the things that undergird what America should be. Except, even when you go back and look at some of the Northern historians writing after the war, you go back to the early 20th century and what's often called the fusion period. You did have Southerners writing, hey, look, you know, we had this conclave, was about the Constitution, what the powers of the Constitution were, et cetera, et cetera. But even there, they still said, well, I mean, slavery was part of that because, you know, that's something the central government couldn't touch. Okay, so there were Southerners that said these things. And they weren't hiding it. And this is the thing that all these people say, well, the lost causers were trying to hide this. No, they weren't. Go back and read it. They talk about it all the time. All the time. Then they'll say that we're glad slavery is over and it ended and we can move on now. Let's be a reunified America. That's gone. That's good. A group that's still interested in the preservation of that institution wouldn't say these kind of things. They wouldn't say, you know, that's good. It's gone. We're reunified. Let's get back together. Let's do what we got to do. Let's have a unified country and move forward. And you know what? The North was fine with that. Because people like James Forbes Rhodes, who was by no means a pro-Southern zealot. In fact, he didn't think the South was right at all. But he said, and this is by in 1890 he said this, well, maybe Reconstruction was a pretty bad deal. Maybe that wasn't something we should have been doing. But he wasn't in favor of the South. This is, I mean, the fusion was, hey, look, all right, you say Lincoln's okay in the South, the Union, we're back together, all that's good, slavery's over, that's all good. We'll say that some of your heroes, you know, Jackson and Lee and these people, and the Southern soldier in general were heroic, they were fighting for their cause, whatever that was, and it was, I mean, we can even say what it was, Northerners did say, but these people were heroic, and they deserve our respect. We're in a reunified America. Everything is good. In fact, what's really at stake here is not the war. It's not the war. It's Reconstruction. It's reconciliation. That's what people like Jill Filipovic and Jamel Bowie, who she mentions in this piece, don't like. But then she says this, I was raised in the northwesternmost corner of the U.S. in Washington, a state that during the Civil War was neither Union nor Confederate nor a state at all. Well, what's interesting about that western areas, you actually had some people out there. I mean, look at California. California had a pretty sizable population that favored the South during the war. There were people out there that supported the South. I'm sure there were people in Washington that did. But she says, what I learned about the Civil War growing up there was fairly straightforward. Southern states wanted to continue the practice of chattel slavery, which was often discussed in terms of the economy. The Southern economy being powered by forced, unpaid, lifelong labor. It's being powered by that. Except, there's a little problem with that narrative. The Southern economy was powered by small farmers, most of whom did not own slaves. Most of whom did not own slaves. That's what was powering the Southern economy. Yes, you had large slave owners, which is a very small, a fraction of the Southern society. And yes, they had tremendous political influence. And yes, you had other Southerners who had fewer amounts of slaves that would generally tend to be on the same side as these people, but not always. But the real power of the Southern economy was agriculture. And it wasn't just cash crops. It was agriculture by the entire South. This is what was pointed out in all the years leading up to 1860. This is why Northern secessionists in the 1790s and early 1800s wanted to leave the Union, because they didn't want to be a union with all these farmers. It didn't matter if they were North or West. It was farmers. And when you look at the South, the backbone of the Southern economy was agriculture, and primarily agriculture that did not use slave labor. That's the backbone of the economy. Yeah, I mean, you had large cash crops and people were producing stuff, and slaves were a main part of that. But Southerners also produced a lot of other things that didn't come from slave labor. So, but she's saying it's fair. The Southern states wanted to continue the practice of chattel slavery, which was the economy. And states' rights refused to bow to federal authorities, specifically, any laws that sought to regulate or end slavery. Really. So the whole time, leading up to 1860, this is what they were worried about, laws that would do that. Now, I mean, they did talk about it sometimes. But that bank thing is pretty important. Same thing with internal improvement, same thing with tariffs. All those things are pretty important. In fact, this Federalist position, where we have a federation of states, was pretty important for a lot of people, because that's how you maintained a union. When Calhoun said that, you know, we have to, with the Calhoun resolutions, the point was, yes, we want to extend, or we want to have the territories open for slave owners. It didn't mean that they were going to extend slavery. And this is kind of a point Jefferson Davis made, and Thomas Jefferson even made this point. You don't really extend slavery. You just move it from one place to another. It doesn't add any more slaves. It's just moving a slave from Virginia to, Arizona. It doesn't add slaves. It just moves them from one place to another. In fact, Jefferson thought that would end slavery. It would diffuse it and it would go away. But anyways, we could argue whether that wouldn't happen or not. But regardless, that's not what they were worried about. When Abraham Lincoln, who opposed the expansion of slavery, was elected in 1860, Southern leaders were irate, the South seceded, and the war began. Well, that's a really sophomoric way of looking at what happened there. When Lincoln was elected in 1860, Southern leaders were irate. That's true. The South seceded, 1861, and the war began. So the war began immediately when the South seceded. No, false. It didn't begin until Lincoln said he was going to provision Sumter and Pickens, and he was going to use force to collect the tariff. That's when the war began. Because even when the South seceded, there was no war. It wasn't war until Lincoln made a conscious choice to have war. That's when the war began, to preserve the Union. And then she says, that is not what many school children in the American South learn. Oh, this is what I got in Washington State, but in the South, in the Deep South, they learn something else. They learn this insidious past, these things that are just so ahistorical. Some textbooks portray enslaved people as well-treated and happy with their lives. Now, I have never seen a textbook, I guess they exist, maybe, where they say that slaves were happy with their lives. But I will tell you that if you look at the literature on slavery that was produced in the 1970s, now I know we're talking about ancient history here, 1970s, and it's written by a bunch of people who at that time in particular were not even interested in a pro-Southern position, who called Southerners all kinds of horrible things. I'm talking about these rabid pro-Southerners like Fogel and Engerman and Eugene Genovese. Now, Genovese would eventually kind of admire the South, but in the 1970s, when he wrote Roll, Jordan, Roll, and when Fogel and Engerman wrote Time on the Cross, these were not pro-Southern partisans. And what did they find? Well, in terms of material conditions and comparative history, this isn't a false statement. that American slaves were treated differently than slaves throughout the world, and that materially they weren't that bad off compared to other laboring peoples. That's their conclusion. I'm just telling you what Fogel and Engerman found. So to say this, you see, there's ideology in this. You can't say that. You can't say these things. Why? Why can't you say these things? Why can't you say that, well, I mean, looking at these things comparatively, and looking at it based on the historical evidence of Fogel and Engerman and Eugene Genovese, not Brion McClanahan, but people have actually gone out and looked at this. And I mean, historians have talked about this for years, 50 years now. This isn't a false statement. Were they happy with their lives? No. I don't think that any of these people said that. Did they have some things to say about slavery when the war was over compared to what they got, which was sharecropping and some other things? Yeah. And sometimes they would make statements that slavery was a little easier. These are true things. The historical record is there. But you can't say that stuff now because, well, that doesn't fit with the racial animus agenda. You see, she is the one that's ideologically in a disposition not to want to accept some of the narrative. The white Southern narrative of the lost cause, which holds that the war was nobly fought over freedom and states' rights, upon which the North was infringing rather than over slavery, remains entrenched. Well, they do talk about slavery. I mean, if you ever read Pollard in The Lost Cause, he does talk about slavery quite a bit, in fact. They don't say that slavery wasn't important. Of course they do. They say it all the time. You just got to go read it. See, these people have never even read this stuff. They just read what they think it says and what they think it believes, and they don't really know. But they do talk about states' rights and freedom. They talk about the Constitution. They say, look, we had a Constitution that had certain defined powers and the central government couldn't do X, Y, and Z and had been doing those things for years. And so, therefore, this was the final straw that broke the camel's back. Right? This was it. Because we thought that was going to be the thing. It was certainly part of leading into it, but the real underlying principle, right, the real underlying problem was this distortion of the government. Now, the union said they weren't going to do anything about that. That's the whole key again. We're not going to interfere with it. We're not. What are you talking about? We're not going to do this. In fact, the 1860 Republican Party platform, which, as I've talked about on the show, was very important, platforms meant everything, said that we believe in states' rights. We believe in the South to do whatever they want with their own domestic institutions. That's their business. That's what they said. Why exactly the Southern states wanted to be free to do remains necessarily vague. Necessarily vague. Well, just like what any other state would want to be free to do, even in the North, like, I don't know, Kentucky, which still had, I mean, you say that Kentucky's in the Union. Well, it had slave auctions until November of 1865, when the war's over. I don't know, like maybe Kentucky, whatever they want to do, or maybe New Jersey, which still had essentially indentured servitude up until December of 1865. I don't know, maybe those kind of things. Maybe. Confederate soldiers are still remembered as heroes. Southern Civil War memorials, many of them erected not in the post-war period, but during the civil rights era of the 1950s and 60s? Now, that's the most idiotic statement she's made. Many of them erected. That would make it sound like nobody's putting these things up until the 1950s and 60s. Now, she didn't say most. She said many. In fact, that's a false statement. The majority of these memorials were put up between 1880 and 19-teens. Well, why? I don't know. Maybe because that's like, you know, 1890s, 25 years on, you're getting into the 50-year period. Maybe. That's why they were being put up in the North as well at the same time when you had a remembrance, you had all these things going on. But no, no, no. According to Dippy Jill Filipovic, they're put up in the 1950s and 60s. You could even pull the charts. There aren't a whole lot of, I mean, there are some memorials going up at that time, but most of them. And what's going on in the 1950s and 60s? I don't know, something called the Civil War Centennial? This is just so stupid. They're put up during the Civil Rights era. correlation does not mean causation, but anyways. That men of honor might forever know the responsibilities of freedom. Dedicated South Carolinians stood and recounted for their heritage and convictions, one reads. I mean, okay. Well, that's true. That's not a false statement. That's a true statement. The pre-Civil War South was not a democracy. It wasn't? Well, that would be news to the people in the pre-Civil War South, nor did it aspire to be. It was and wanted to continue being a harshly authoritarian state. Again, that would have been news to the South. Nationally, the right to vote was originally reserved for a minority. White male landowners who were determined to preserve their tradition of white minority rule. Well, what she says this is in the South, but then nationally this was done. But this was only in the South, but it was national. In fact, this was not on anywhere, show me, until the 1860s where blacks could vote or women could vote or any of that. This was something that was accepted across the United States. And the last time I checked, the South had universal white male suffrage on the eve of the war. I mean, they had that just like the North had that. But no, this was not a democracy and it didn't aspire to be a democracy. What the heck does that even mean? This is the dumbest statement in the entire piece. Nationally, the right to vote was originally reserved for a minority white male landowners who were determined to preserve their tradition of white minority rule. Now, that's also a really weird statement. Because in 1860, the black population of America was about 13%. So she's saying nationally. So whites were interested in white minority rule. Now, in two states, in Mississippi and South Carolina, whites were the minority. But in every other state of the South, they were the majority. So how is this white minority rule? Again, this woman is so stupid, she can't even get out of her own way. Words such as freedom and liberty were bandied about, but in a sense that can only be described as Orwellian, meaning liberty for some enabled by the blatant and violent subjugation of others. So, again, reading this, you would think that Northerners had some other concept of this. Blacks couldn't vote in the North. Women couldn't vote in the North. There's a really great website, Slave North, if you ever want to get this. SlaveNorth.org, I think, or .com. I can't remember what it is. But if you ever want to read more about what the North was doing, just go get that. This is just completely ridiculous. It's, again, it's one of the dumbest things she said in the entire piece. But, there's more. As Jamel Bowie wrote in the New York Times Magazine in 2019, one of the men dedicated to upholding this system, John C. Calhoun, vice president from 25 to 32, 18, was an astute politician, quote, was an astute politician, but he made his most important mark as a theoretician of reaction. A man who, realizing that democracy could not protect slavery in perpetuity, set out to limit democracy. No, false. He was against what he called the tyranny of the numerical majority, but he wasn't against democracy at all. He thought there should be a check on unbridled 50% plus one. That's not democracy. I mean, what is democracy anyways? It's majority rule. So he would say we need a real majority, something that's supported by all, not just a slim majority, where half the population is going to be under some kind of tyranny. But once you invoke Calhoun, he's a defender of slavery, you see. Now, there's an interesting thing about Calhoun. The most recent biography by Robert Elder of Calhoun says, you know, this is in the conclusion. When Calhoun would say things that we would look at and kind of recoil at, that you know, America is a white government, a white population, a white society, whatever it is. These are kind of things Calhoun would say. Everybody believed that in the 1840s. That was the dominant American position. Not Southern, but American position. And you know who else says things like that? I don't know, someone like Abraham Lincoln or David Wilmot. This is the things they said. But no, no, no. John C. Calhoun believed that liberty, quote, was a reward to be earned, not a blessing to be gratuitously lavished on all alike. A reward reserved for the intelligent, the patriotic, the virtuous, and deserving. Not a boon to be bestowed on a people too ignorant, degraded, and vicious to be capable of enjoying it. End quote. Well, if you go back and look at Western civilization, these are the kind of things people would say about all kinds of populations. But you think the Athenians would have said that anyone but Athenians were deserving of democracy or liberty, or Athenian liberty? No. Would the Spartans have said this? No. Would the Romans have even said this? No. They wouldn't have said you should get all these things, these blessings of the Roman. They ruled with a heavy hand of all their populations they controlled. This was not unusual. Would English liberty be designed for anybody but English people? No. Why do you think the English ruled the way they did in the colonial period, or the British? Because they didn't think all these people were capable of what they had. This was not an unusual statement for people in the 19th century, 18th century, 17th century, 16th century. We've only come to think this is a strange statement in the 20th and 21st century, in the last 200 years. But for most of human history, this is a statement people would have made. Again, it's a historically ignorant presentist view that is designed to have an ideological end, which is these people are bad, we can't believe them, and so because they had these views that don't fit with us today, so look, but you know what? Who are you going to find? I mean, you're going to find Abraham Lincoln saying the exact same things. It's just stupid. These ideas have never disappeared. I don't think you'd find many people saying, you know, the kind of racist things that 19th century Americans said today. You're just not going to find it in positions of power in particular. But Calhoun was the justification. They, meaning Calhoun saying this, was the justification for Jim Crow, America's racial apartheid system, and for voting rules that first formally prevented most Americans from voting and later kept racial minorities and black Americans from their legal rights to cast a ballot. So that's Calhoun was making these things happen in the North when it was the North that actually invented Jim Crow to begin with. Again, even the Washington Post recognized this. Go out and this is so historically ignorant, it's not even funny. So Calhoun's words were the justification for Jim Crow, except Jim Crow already existed when Calhoun said these things. And they're also the inspiration, justification for voting rules that first formally prevented most Americans from voting, what Calhoun said. But you see, the North had the exact same voting rules. So how is it that Calhoun in the South was the justification for what the North was doing? Again, if you want to see what kind of government society the North wanted, let's look at what happened right after the war. That's what they wanted. Now, you could say, yeah, the radical Republicans. No. That was a minority of the Republican Party, and they knew it, which is why they had to try to rig the game to win. Most Americans were not in favor of that, North and South. And later kept racial minorities and black Americans from their legal right to cast a ballot. You hear echoes of them now in conservative talking points about ending birthright citizenship, about unproven voter fraud conspiracies, and about undeserving welfare recipients, about a state's right to force a woman to have a child, about how real Americans are having their birthrights stolen. You see, these are just the talking points from conservatives. Unproven voter fraud conspiracies. What about unproven voter suppression conspiracy theories? That's not out there. Because if you want to cast a vote in 2024, you can do it. In fact, we're going to have, you know, voting, not election day, we're going to have election month. Maybe even election 6 months or election year. You can start voting whenever. Just start voting now. You can start voting for 2026 and 2024, I'm sure. The Republicans, once the party of Lincoln, experienced a national realignment in the 1960s with the passage of civil rights legislation as racist, authoritarian whites fled the Democratic Party for the GOP. False. That's all been proven false. The GOP has never changed. Their positions are still aligned with what they were saying in the 1860s. I've talked about this on this show before. There was no flip. Again, this is historically ignorant. There's no flip. And you didn't have, I mean, Democrats still stayed Democrats. Some would switch, but Democrats still say Democrats. I mean, look at how the South voted even after the 1960s. Yeah, they went for Goldwater. And they went for Goldwater in 64. And, you know, Nixon was able to pick up on the South in 68 and 72, but the South voted the other way in several elections. This is just silly. The desire for minority rule is mainstream in today's Republican Party. Minority rule. Again, what does that mean? Minority rule. No. It's not minority. I would define the minority. Which has overturned voting rights legislation and made it more difficult for many to participate in democracy. False. That's a false statement. It almost overturned any voting rights legislation. Nothing has been overturned. That's a complete false statement, but again, stupid. The desire for authoritarianism has long been an undercurrent of conservative politics, but came to the fore in the Trump era. As Matthew C. McWilliams wrote in Politico in 2020, the single factor that predicated whether a Republican primary voter supported Trump over his rivals was an inclination to authoritarianism. Oh yeah, because Matthew McWilliams said it is true. That's false. This thing is... Again, it's just a bunch of nonsense. Authoritarianism or democracy? Majority rule with minority protections or minority rule with majority marginalization? That's her majority rule with minority protections. That's exactly what Calhoun would have said. So what's the majority? She's saying minority rule with majority marginalization. How do you measure the majority? Is that a racial majority, a political majority? What is it? And I mean, are we talking about the United States? Are we talking about a state? Because, you know, for example, in a conservative state, the majority would be conservative in that state. So are those people supposed to be subject to the minority of that state? Is that what you're arguing here? Because, I mean, I'm confused about this now. These are the questions that have shaped U.S. politics since the country's inception. But I thought it was just the South. These are the questions that sent Americans to war with each other in the late 18th century. Or, sorry, 19th century. But I thought it was just the South. In the late 19th century? Since when are the 1860s the late 19th century? That's the mid-19th century. But I guess we went to war with each other in the 1890s. I don't know. Did we go to war with... I mean, is the Spanish-American War then about the... These things? I have no idea. I mean, this piece is just all over the place. And they are the questions that still define American politics more sharply than ever in the age of Donald Trump. A man who routinely claims to hate losers, even as he takes up their lost cause. Oh yeah, I'm going to call Trump a loser. I mean, this is the kind of junk that you get from these idiotic people writing this stuff. And again, Filipovic, I think she posted this on her social media feed. It's just so stupid, and she only had a few comments about it. Most of it was, oh, that's great. Oh, I'm not good at this like Jamel Bowie, I think she said. I'm not very good at doing these things. Well, clearly, you're not good at any of this. In fact, I mean, I don't know if you have enough brain cells to make anything work here. But regardless, she really needs... some of the statements here she just drops are completely ahistorical. This is the dumbest piece ever. But anyways, it's a great podcast, fodder. See you next time with the Brion McClanahan Show. See you then.